okay, just climbed in the airplane, and part of the experience of this thing is starting the airplane. It requires external power. It requires 1,000 to 1,200 amps power, 28 volt DC, just to spin the engine up to speed. So procedure for starting it is, you wind up the starter, engage the starter. Then you move the throttle outboard, and what that does is turns the boost pumps on. And then at 6%, you take it off the cutoff spot, and you start advancing the fuel. You see the fuel flow jump, and you slowly advance the throttle towards idle. And you'll watch the tailpipe temp all of a sudden will start building. And you just with your throttle, you manually regulate it. You bring it up to about 650 degrees centigrade. And as long as you keep it up around 600 to 700, the engine will accelerate on up until you call what's going around the horn, and that's the idle stop. The engine's at 35%, 35 to 37% at idle. And the ignition shuts off, the starter shuts off. It's a starter slash generator. It's not a starter generator. It has two functions. So the starter itself cuts out at about 25%, and the generator starts to work at that time. It's actually got, like I say, it's two separate units in the same deal. Okay, and then the engine's idling at 35 to 37%. Then at that time, we call the ground crew to pull the APU cord. And then we get everybody to step back and signal the crew chief. Whoever's watching out there, does he see anything leaking or whatever? And then we go through a pre-takeoff check, which is basically we close the gear doors. We have them open for inspection, so we flip a switch and the gear doors all close up, and he gives me thumbs up, they're closed. Then the speed brakes are open. I give them a signal, and he says they're clear, so we close them up. And the whole time I'm watching these three different hydraulic systems in the airplane. And then the flight control system, which is the most critical part. What we do is the engine-driven system takes over, and at 3,000 pounds, we move all the flight controls around, make sure they all work and everything's normal, elevators and ailerons. And then what we do is move the controls around excessively. When the engine's at idle, you can get the pressure down to about 600 pounds, and then it will automatically change over to the electric. So we check in the electric changeover and make sure the controls all work electrically, and then you manually switch it back. There's a switch right behind the throttle. You put it back into the normal flight controls. Flaps full down for takeoff, and then we just go through our normal stuff, ground control, taxi out for takeoff. Taxi out is just monitor the engine, make sure everything is normal and the generator's working. The air to the external fuel tanks is on. In other words, the drop tanks are selected. And the trim is set. Trim's real important on the Sabre because you're just positioning the stick. So if the stick is positioned way forward, when you pull back for takeoff, I mean, you'd be pulling against spring bungees, and it's almost impossible to pull the stick full aft when it's trimmed all the way forward. So the trim in the F-86 for takeoff setting is almost full aft. It's full aft, and then you go forward about a one or two count. And taxiing the Sabre is real simple. If there's anything critical about the F-86, you could say two things. One thing, it uses a lot of gas. And the other thing is the nose wheel steering is crappy. Just because it's so sensitive. So there's a button, the very bottom button, you hit your pinky on the stick, you hold down, and that engages the hydraulic valve that follows the rudder around. So most Sabres have a lot of slop, and when you're taxiing, you're just kind of going left, right, with the rudder pedals trying to keep it straight. Our airplane was pretty loose, and we put a brand new nose gear in it, so it's actually taxi's pretty good for a Sabre, but that's about it. And the engine is idling at more than 2 gallons a minute, just idling. So we try to get all our flight planning ahead of time, and expedite, without being ridiculous, but expedite to the end of the runway. And before we even come to a stop, I'll call, I'm ready to take off. Because once you bring things to a stop, then you got to wind it back up to get it to move again and make a turn. So especially if nobody else is, we're just going VFR here, so nobody else in the area at the run up will just ask for takeoff. And usually they'll just let us turn the corner and go. Okay, before takeoff check, we're going to run the engine up to 88%. We're holding the brakes. And then we turn the emergency fuel control on. And we get a drop in RPM, and then we go to full throttle, and we should get a predetermined amount of RPM. It's usually around 96 or 97% on the emergency fuel control. Then we turn the emergency fuel control off with a switch. You just turn it off, and the engine rips right up to 100%. And then you cycle it again. You go back to emergency, it drops back down. And you do that three times. Do that first flight of the day. It's important to cycle all the valves in the engine, but that's the procedure. And then final check is look over and see if you've got more than 650 degrees on the tailpipe temp. And then I wiggle the flight controls just to make sure they work. I watch hydraulic pressure gauge, so then I let go of the brakes. And the F86F, with 6,000 pounds of thrust, doesn't really accelerate real hard. You see a little haze coming out, and that's just the air conditioner. It's vapor coming out, and sometimes it'll throw snowballs at you, spit ice and things like that on a real humid day. But anyway, so with our fuel load and all, we're going to start the nose up at about 100, 105. We start to stick back, and it comes off the runway about 120, 115 to 120. Gear up right away, and going through 140 knots, put the flaps up. And it's pretty shallow climb angle. The F-86 needs a lot of airspeed to climb. You know, its best rate of climb to sea level is 430 knots. But with the rules and regulations, you know, we'll try to keep it around 250. It doesn't climb very good at 250 knots. And the F takes a little while to get going, get it all clean and get the speed up. But once we hit going through 250, I'll pull it back about 98%. And out of Chino going VFR, we have to be below 2,500 feet under the airspace above us just for a few miles until we get down around Corona. And so we're throttling way back by then because we just go too fast. But you can see, it trims pretty hands-off, but you're always trimming it. You know, you start with the stick almost full aft on takeoff, and then you start trimming it forward as the airspeed goes. And your engine's, the noise of the air, it's a buzz, sounds like a big elevator, and it hums, but it's really smooth. It's a beautiful feeling airplane. And in the 86, we sit on a hot seat, so charges we have them x-rayed. They're old charges, but that's a risk that we take. The airplane, because of its nature and because of full power flight controls, there isn't a lot you can do. If you're cruising along and decide to get out of it, you couldn't even get out of it without the ejection seat. So, but we were a backpack parachute, which is really the seat's made for it. It's a Air Force's B-22 parachute, they call it, and it's got it's a high speed chute. The seat in this airplane, too, is kind of funny when you sit in it. It's a North American airplane, but it's got a Mitsubishi insignia on the foot pedals for the seat. And the seat is the very latest seat they made in the 70s for the Sabre jets. And the Japanese, it was built for the Japanese because they used them all the way into the 80s. And it's a rocket seat with a man seat separator, and it's advertised to be zero altitude at 120 knots. But we do our best to make sure that we don't need the seat. The airplane's got 7,000 hours on it and hasn't needed the seat. So there you go. There's a couple of people asked for some information here. Some people want to know more about the tailpipe insert. So it's pretty simple. They're just little angles that just reduce the size of the tailpipe. So as part of the checks, our maintenance checks, usually you only have to do it on engine installations because every engine is just a little different. There's a procedure for doing it, though. You don't just pick one. You start at the bottom and you work around the sides. Some engines don't require it. Some engines require all of them. So it's just the way it is. And there's another question someone asked, if there was a two-seat Sabre to get checked out. Well, they built two of them back in the 50s. Matter of fact, one of them was only a few numbers off of this one. It was modified, so it was a regular fighter that they made into a two-place. But both those airplanes were lost. So the checkout in the 86 is, once you're familiar with flying jets, usually with the T-33, that's how the Air Force did it. And that's how I did it. I wasn't a military guy, but I'd flown Mustangs and Hellcats and Corsairs and things like that as a young man. And I was 22 when I got checked out, so I got an Air Force guy checked me out, a guy named Ross Deal. He was kind of my mentor growing up. He was an ex-F-86 guy, a Western Airlines pilot, and a Lockheed test pilot, too. So he ran me through the ringer and the T-Bird, and so I soloed that for a while, and then flew the 86 a little bit, and my first off run with F-86. That summer I got a job with Bob Hoover flying his F-86 for his air show. So the first trip I had was from Chino to Oshkosh. So it was a Mark V Sabre, a hard wing, modified with the same wing this F has, the F-35 wing, and flew to Oshkosh. 22 years old, so it's pretty cool. It's a really easy plane to fly. Like I say, if you get the proper training and you get the right attitude, I love it. It's my favorite airplane to fly. Then somebody asked a question about the airplane's panels. How were they shaped? Did they use a wheel? Everything was stamped. This is a production. They made 9,000 F-86s, so in the production line, everything is just stamped out. Now, final fitting is one thing. They probably did a few little things on that. Another question about the 6-3 wing. You'll read some books, 6-3 hard edge wing. Well, that was the first original design. Like I said earlier, adding 6 inches to the root, 3 inches to the tip, it changed the angle of the sweep. That's all the 6-3 did. And it helped the airplane at its high speed near supersonic. It helped how the wing would transition. And they had and the slats or hard wing, 6-3 wing. So that's what that's all about. And F-86Fs originally went to Korea did not have slats. They had just hard edge and fences, what they call, which is a vertical piece of metal, one in each wing, and it helped the spillage of air made it go straight back instead of sliding down the wing at certain speeds. So. Slats help quite a bit at slow speed, and those slow the airplane 15 knots, or about 10 to 15 knots on approach. The hard wing, like I say, is a pretty slippery airplane by comparison. It just uses a lot more runway. A hard wing airplane, too, on a hot day, you can over-rotate it and get it where it's behind the power curve, and you lost a lot of Sabres that way in training. Guys, on a hot day, take off, rotate too soon and pull the nose up too high, and then you're just stuck, you're hanging there. You can't reduce your angle of attack, you hit the ground, and so a lot of planes augured in that way. But here it is, all about training and experience. And the first, somebody asked when the first Sabre flew. I think it was 1947, I think. It was a straight wing airplane, 46, straight wing, and then they put the swept wing on it. Held the world speed record at one time. About center of gravity, we carry a lot of extra weight. We have 3 batteries up in the nose and a couple hundred pounds of lead in the nose to offset the weight of the guns. Yeah, the guns were heavy and the ammo was heavy. We ferried some of these things out of Canada in the 70s too, and we put 800 pounds of lead in the ammo cans to make up for the lack of guns. I think it was 800 pounds, maybe it was 700 pounds. I don't remember now, I think. But yeah, it takes a lot to get the thing in CG, we've, like say, put the batteries up front and moving some things around. We're able to keep it as light as it could be. Yeah, this flight is a flight organized with Scott Slocum. He's kind of a famous aviation aerial photographer, and he arranged to meet up with us, and we went to the area, which is just east of March Air Force Base, around Hemet, French Valley area, so we can fly a little lower, get some background, and not be in any controlled airspace that we would conflict with anybody. So he's in a Baron, and he can do about 170 knots indicated, so we just got to get the airplane slowed down. You know, the Sabre flies actually really fine at that speed, but getting it from, you know, like when I took off from Chino, I climbed to 250 knots, went to 10,000 feet, went to 400 and some knots, and then I slowed down, came back down, and then I really slowed down. And you know, in the pictures with the flaps up and with the slats, you know, it's no problem. The joint up is what we brief anyway. You know, keep him in a turn, and because I can, if he stays in a turn, you know, I'll need 20 or 30 knots extra just to be on his wing. So here's kind of the joint up. You can see I kind of came inside and slid out. I got the speed brakes out. Put them out before you pull the throttle back. If you pull the throttle back and then add the speed brakes, then you got the engine slow to accelerate. So there's just little tricks in flying formation that you'll learn the more you do it. So. But it's real stable. If you watch a video, you can see I'm really not moving the controls too much. And you can, without a prop, you can really get close. And when you're flying a prop airplane, you got to remember, if you go back and forth, you got to remember, oh, geez, this thing has a prop. So, but you can tuck the 86 right in there. It's a beautiful airplane. And stressing the trim again, too, that it's an airplane you just trim all the time. Because when you're trimming it, you're moving the stick, basically. So, I mean, as the airplane slows down, you got to roll it back. And aileron trim is insignificant. You almost never touch that. You never use the rotor trim. It's just all about, you know, taking off full aft, and as you accelerate on up, you're just rolling that trim forward. And that's just the you know, design of the wing. It flies with a lot of angle of attack with a sweep. And the faster you go, the angle of attack goes away, and it goes away pretty rapidly too. So sometimes you're just laying on the trim just to keep up with it. Especially with that Mark 6 Sabre, the Canadian one, it's got a lot more horsepower. It's got 1,300 pounds more thrust, and you're pretty much, you know, full throttle, rotate, gear up, flaps up, and then your fingers right on the trim rolling forward, and you know, because it accelerates pretty hard. We here, you know, we tried different positions around the airplane, you know, in trail, and they always want you to back up because they want the airplane with a bunch of background too, so it's actually harder to fly when the airplane is, when you go more than 50 or 60 feet away. Sometimes they want you way out or up or down or whatever, but, you know, that's their choice. You know, they're the artists, so we're just trying to accommodate with their needs. But you can see I'm not moving the stick very much. You move it a little bit like anything else. And the engine at speed too, there's a lot of drag because the nose cocked up, so the engine isn't near idle. It's running 70 to 80% RPM, which isn't percent of power. That's just percent of engine RPM. And from about 50% on up, you can just move the throttle all you want. When you're below 50%, that's when you've got to be careful to anticipate it, because it'll take from idle, in-flight idle, you know, it'll idle in-flight maybe 40% with throttle all the way back. And from that to full power, you know, it could take 10, 12, 13 seconds to go all the way up with it. But if you're around 50%, you can just push it on up, and it'll put you right back in the seat pretty good. And you can see, look at the paint job on the side of the canopy rails. That's PRC, or that liquid rubber that dries. It's flexible. Well, the canopy actually flexes, so that's why the paint is all chipped out there, just to that do the pressurization. Not in this flight, of course, but when you pressurize it, everything kind of moves around. But it's a nice, quiet cockpit, although the buzzing and humming of the engine and the systems, but the airplane's really smooth. So we're about ready to wrap this up, and the GoPro ran out of film before we landed, but it's always fun to do these little photo jobs, and especially when you work with pros. And we've been fortunate enough to be able to brief and fly with a lot of great pilots, including Scott, and guys that know what they're doing, know what they want. That's the biggest thing. You don't want to waste a lot of time. We do a lot of briefing. People we don't know especially, we'll spend a lot of time briefing and it's real serious business when you're flying close to each other up there. Just lucky to be able to do this, and we'll hopefully you can keep on doing it. My goal is to do this for a long time, so we'll just see how much gas is left in the tank.
If you liked this video, please subscribe and leave your questions or suggestions for our next video in the comments below.